Blessings and peace, blessings and peace. And many manifestations to you. I ask the our Father to bless your heart and mind with this message, and may it add and increase to your understanding. Father, I ask that you're able to open up my spiritual eye to help me to connect and fellowship with the pain of the listeners and help guide them back to you, and to give them a message that will deliver them out of their darkness, out of their struggle, and out of their pain, and bring them into a place of perfect peace. So Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the opportunity for redemption and the washing of our sins from our fleshly understanding to our behavior. But Father, I ask that you're able to forgive us and deliver us from the path of evil and from the evildoers. For us to walk in your wisdom, your understanding, your knowledge, and your spirit. And Father, I ask that this message really opens up the ones that are listening. And Father, I ask that you're able to have me centered and to have me still so I can channel the message in a right way that it can communicate to your children, to provide them with the nourishment, the healing, the strength, the encouragement, and the power and the glory in your son's name. Thank you for this message. You know, as of lately, I've been creating, you know, content, a lot of things I've had in storage. Today I had three different ideas of putting out different messages, and throughout the process I was consumed by certain distractions. So I believe that was Most High telling me not right now, and we can leave that message alone. And through a conversation with a dear friend of mine, this particular verse popped up in my mind. And the reason why it popped up in my mind, because I feel like this is, you know, where my state is. And I don't know if this is where you're at, but hopefully we can come to a place of clarity and be renewed in our mind, body, and spirit. Now this is Yeshua giving his agonizing prayer in the garden. In Matthew 26, verse 36, I'm going to read to 39. Then Yeshua went with them to the olive grove called Gethsemane. And he said, "Sit here while I go over there to pray." He took Peter and Zebedee, two sons, James and John, and he became anguished and distressed. He told them, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." He went on a little farther and bowed with his face to the ground, praying, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup of suffering be taken away from me. Yet, I want your will to be mine." Some things you think about when you think about the cup of suffering, and what is in the cup of suffering. It's the wrath of God. It's our fallen nature, our fleshly understanding, our base way of thinking and behaving and believing. And it trips us up a lot of the times. How many times have you got to a place where you've felt mentally, emotionally, psychologically, and spiritually drained? Completely drained. Towards though you have faith, right? But in some area in your life, you feel defeated. I try to throw a party, and the guy upstairs complains. Maybe in the external sense, or maybe in the internal sense. Now, you can have money, but money doesn't hide too many things. Money is more so like fig leaves, you know, just like material things is fig leaves. It covers something. It covers a hole that it covers a void that needs to be filled. See, one thing that we can all relate to, regardless of gender, skin color, age, economic condition, and etc., we are all struggling. We are all suffering in the internal state of our being. One of the things that stuck out to me when I was reading this scripture was, actually it was a couple things. It was the olive grove called Gethsemane. Now, the olive grove is an extremely slow-growing plant, which is the olive tree that requires years of patient labor to reach full fruitfulness. The outer fleshy part of the oval-shaped fruit is what yields the highly valuable commodity of olive oil, or the anointing, charisma. See, the olive tree is symbolic to peace and reconciliation. Ever since the account of the flood and Noah's ark, Ark of Safety. It's key, right? That's from the flood. And what is the flood symbolic to? The flood is symbolic to our state of unconsciousness, our state of flesh. Just like in Genesis 8:11, the dove brought Noah a plucked olive leaf as a symbol of new life. Now let's look at the process by which olives need to be beaten and crushed in order to produce olive oil. The flow of the anointing, the flow of Christos, or the charisma. See, Yahshua was beaten and crushed on the cross so that his Holy Spirit, or Christos, would be poured out into the church, or the body of believers. See, Yahshua is God's olive tree, and the Holy Spirit, Christos, is the olive oil. And Gethsemane, what is that symbolic to? The oil press, urgence, and anointments. The process of being beaten and crushed arrives from the internal conflict and our state of consciousness when truth becomes one cold reality that we face in our fallen state. Now, this is being totally stripped of ourself to incorporate a method of psychological regeneration. A new belief system in our state of consciousness. See, the Garden of Gethsemane was at the bottom of the valley between the Holy City and a Mount of Olives. Now, if you look at our cross or the cross of crucifixion, what is it symbolic to? The four hemispheres, which is circumference of the zodiac in 360 degrees. The east is symbolic to our intellect and learning. The south is our ambition and intuition. The west is our feelings and emotions. The north is our wealth, health, and security. See, these things have to be laid down and surrendered in order for the balance. Because in these aspects, the cross or our branches of suffering needs to be brought into that place where it's centered on the axis within our psyche, in ourselves, so that the inner man or our solar light power or anointing or olive oil can be raised in levels of our awareness, because there's seven dimensions in the spirit chakra. See, the cross represents our state of consciousness and our mortal self or carnal mind, or the burdens of our base level understanding and human emotions. See, the denying of ourselves from our lower frequency that is within us is only through meditation or thinking things through the internal inclination of what scripture says, and pressing it through us. So we go through the process of being crushed, being crucified, until that word is beaten into us. So what are we crucifying? What is the cross symbolic to crucifying? Is the five senses in order to be in fellowship with the Creator. Now, if you look at the five senses, it's symbolic to the five I wills. And that's what caused Lucifer to fall and become Satan. Or the five senses under the guise of our lower self. How do we get that balance back of being centered in Yah or Yahweh? Now, you look at the yin and the yang, the balance of the masculine and feminine principle. Yah, male, way, female. This phrase, I am that I am, we get both the male and female principle reunited in oneness of God. The bride in Christ. There's no greater love than laying down of your lower self for your brethren, to raise them up in their highest state of consciousness, into their divine fellowship, into their spirit. See, this is what my process is. I'm being crushed in every area of my life. I'm being brought with levels of resistance that I've never had before, where I'm physically, mentally, emotionally, psychologically, and spiritually tired. But I'm still fighting. I'm still praying. Still going through the process. But what's being formed is that raw energy. If you look at the numbers, 3, 6, and 9, right? They said that if you unlock the key to that mystery, you have power. Dunamis. Walk with me. Now, when you think about it, the cat has 9 lives, okay? First 3 lives, you know, the cat, the cat plays the second part, which is 6. The cat strays. Then it's the 9, completeness. The cat is basically at one with the owner. 369, raw energy within the construct of the matrix. You look at the iris of Ra and the pyramid. How is the pyramid formed? 369, right? It's all a triune to connect with God. The masculine, feminine principle combined to the spirit. You look at the mind's eye. What gives you an idea? You ever look in the back of a dollar bill and you see that? Now, getting back to the aspect of how to get there is through the suffering. The suffering is the challenge, the inner conflict within of striving against oneself. That's what Paul is talking about, the thorn in his flesh. It means you could be aware in your state of consciousness, but you're still in your fallen self, fighting. So my grandfather always said, killing another man doesn't make you a man. But killing the nigga inside of you will make you a god. And that's what essentially what we're supposed to be, an earthly master. An ensample. A reflection. See, God is the sun and we're the moon. We're the reflection of what he is. If we are walking in him. Now, if we're walking in our flesh, what are we serving? I pray this message opens your eyes. Not only opens your eyes, but gives you renewed strength, guidance, scope, and submission to that will, to that new state of consciousness, to that new state of being, to basically be totally surrendered unto the spirit. Because our process, right? As they say, famous city, trust the process. So you gotta have trust in Yah in the process. Just like Job, he said, although you slay me, I trust you. Now, have you ever been in a place in your life where your confusion is confused? It looks like things are regressing, right? And you see how this kind of progressing? And it's funny too, because this is a circle around you, but you gotta understand like this. When you think of a slingshot, right? With David, you kind of have to pull back that slingshot. What is the two cords? What is the two cords symbolic to? And what is that rock of salvation? You are as rock, you're being pulled back. You're being in a place of being launched. His word and his power. You trust in his word and you believe in his power, and he'll put you in a place where you belong. He'll make your enemies your footstool. They'll dine with you, your meat of frustration, your wine of agony. See, right now in this moment, you're being raised. That's what the purpose of this message is given to you. You know, You're being raised. You're being made new, and you're being made whole, and you're being delivered. Suffering is what brings you into maturity. It's what brings you into a place of balance. It's what brings you into also a place of humility. Suffering also develops compassion. And love. Togetherness. Peace. Genuineness. See, sometimes God puts you through the process, it puts you through this mess, right? And you ask yourself why. So you can see that guy in that three-piece suit that looks like he has it all together, but you can see it with your spiritual eye and see that he's broken. He might be at a place of suicide. He might be at a place of about to kill somebody. He might be at a place of just really calling it quits. It could be those things, or it could be you seeing you in that man. You seeing your brokenness in that man. Your trials is sometimes someone else's deliverance. Your suffering, in some aspects, is someone's key to their salvation. Your mess will end up being someone else's message. Your confusion will be someone else's compass. Your pain will be someone else's power. Your test will be someone else's testament. How does a man grow without pain? See, it's one thing you can grow in age and calendar years. Another thing you grow in your mentality. In your mentality and your spirit. Now, this message is for men, mainly. But it's not gender sensitive. But it is called for man to basically to be risen and to rise up and to be mature, because if we develop ourselves and become a standard and become a principle, we raise up our women. How can you complain about the body being sick if the head is sick? Are you checking your mental health? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So what do you think of yourself, to yourself, when you're by yourself, talking to yourself, if you talk to yourself? Because they say in Scientific American Mind, 80% of the people that do talk to themselves have better mental health states, and they're also far more intelligent than the average being, because they're looking for outside validation. Because to look outside is to dream. To look inside is to awaken. So what kind of conversation are you having with you? And going back to that olive is a fruit, right? And every fruit reproduces after its own kind. So what are you... what is being reproduced after you? What kind of man are you? What kind of men are being reproduced and regenerated after you? as my brother C. Doug always says, it all comes down to the cut of the man. It all comes down to the cut and the caliber. And if you want to basically know what it takes to be at the highest caliber and the highest cut, you're going to have to suffer. You're going to have to embrace the suffering. You have to embrace the pain. You have to challenge your mind. You're going to have different conversations with yourself. David encouraged himself in the Lord. Are you encouraging yourself in the Lord? In the midst of your pain, in the midst of your agony, in the midst of your confusion. Do you know the criteria of your identity? People say, oh yeah, you have to know thyself. But do you really know yourself well enough to not put yourself in certain places, in certain spaces? Not just physical spaces, but I'm talking about mental and emotional, psychological spaces. Not to entertain certain spirits, but to challenge those spirits. So people talk about the vetting process, but what are you vetting? See, as I'm growing in the spirit, I'm challenging the spirits around me. I don't see that pretty woman. I see the spirit that's behind her. Either if it's good or it's evil, I'm gonna test it, I'm gonna bring it out, I'm gonna shake the tree. Just like the people with their offerings of free lunch to give me something. What is it that you want in return? I gotta basically shake the tree. Like I was talking about in heartfelt masculinity. Now, how is your masculinity heartfelt, brother? How is your femininity felt, sister? It can only be felt through going through the process of suffering. And being honest with yourself in the suffering. See, plausible deniability will fracture your process and the walk. Peace and blessings.